The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio this afternoon is on social justice. I would remind members that if they wish to request a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. And at question number one, I call Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government what the current average processing time is for the adult disability payment applications.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Adult disability payment statistics are published quarterly. The latest release covering the period to the 31st July 2023 shows the improvement actions Social Security Scotland put in place have reduced the median average processing time for normal rules applications by 8 working days. The median average processing time overall since the benefit was introduced is 83 working days. Processing times for cases eligible under the special rules for terminal illness, some of Scotland's most vulnerable people, have also been included in this publication for the first time, and this shows a median average processing time of 2 working days.
Willie Rennie.
But for over 3,500, it took more than 141 days to process their adult disability payment, and the average that the Minister has just set out is way above what was promised by this Government when it set out. The DWP, processing personal independent payments, are doing so faster. How has it got so bad that even the DWP are better than the Scottish Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm sure Mr Rennie is well aware that under the DWP system, a customer, as they call people, are required to collate their own supporting information. This, as has been shown by people that have been involved in the process, to be one of the most stressful aspects of the DWP process. Under the adult disability payment, this collection of supporting information is of course carried out by Social Security Scotland on behalf of the client. Now, that will take time. For example, if information is requested from a health practitioner and so on, but that is one of the reasons why it is not appropriate to consider a comparison, direct comparison with PIP to ADP. But I would say, as I said in my original answer, that there is a number of actions that Social Security Scotland have taken to improve processing times, and I'm happy to provide that in full detail for Mr Rennie in writing.
Supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What reassurance can the Cabinet Secretary give that the adult disability payment application process remains fixed to the core founding principles with fairness, dignity and respect at its heart?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is a very important aspect of everything that Social Security does, and one of the aspects I think that demonstrates that is the example I gave to Mr Rennie in his questions. It is very important that this system was designed, co-designed with people with very, very poor aspects of their care under the DWP, if you can call it care, I suppose, Presiding Officer. But we have seen within the client services reports that have came out from Social Security Scotland very, very high satisfaction rates with the way that their cases have been done, and that they feel they have been treated with dignity, fairness and respect themselves.
Supplementary, Jeremy Balfour, who's joining us online. Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I remind members that I am in receipt of PIP. Cabinet Secretary, a number of individuals have been in touch because they are being denied their exemption from road tax as a disabled person because they are waiting months to be issued their certificate of entitlement for Social Security Scotland. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise whether these delays were anticipated and why nothing has been done to rectify them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Forgive me, Presiding Officer, I didn't pick up part of Mr Balfour's question just at the start, so I'm happy to provide further details in writing if I haven't correctly heard his question. I do, as I said to Mr Rennie, appreciate that there have been delays in adult disability payment. I can, of course, assure everyone, including Mr Balfour, that any payments that are due are backdated to the time of application. But as I say, I maybe didn't pick up Mr Balfour's question correctly, and I'm happy to do so in writing if there's further details that's needed.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As well as adult disability payment, figures for child disability payment show that from the first 6 months of the year, from January to June, only 20.3% of cases were processed within the four-month target, and the median processing time has worsened from 91 working days in December 22 to 102 working days in June 23. Coupled with adult disability payment, isn't it clear that the situation is getting worse and people both in receipt of ADP and families in receipt of CDP are waiting in limbo for these decisions? What is the Cabinet Secretary going to do to deal with both of these issues?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm happy to provide the same information that I would to Mr Rennie on all the actions that Social Security has undertaken. And I would once again say, as I said to committee in a recent appearance, that the agency have invited the committee and its members to come up to Dundee to hear very, very careful and detailed information about exactly what has been put into place. It's unfortunate that the committee have not been able to take up that invitation, which has been outstanding for some time, but I think Mr O'Kane and others would certainly gain a lot of reassurance, and it would allow us to have a more in-depth and a more detailed conversation than we can have in these answers. And I'm happy once again to say on behalf of the agency that they are more than happy to welcome the committee and indeed other members to headquarters if that would help assist with much more detailed information about what is taking place to ensure that swift action improves the processing times.
Question number two, Bob Doris.
To ask the Scottish Government how it supports older people living in poverty to maximise their income.
Cabinet Secretary.
Ensuring financial security in older age is a key priority for this Government, and we are taking a range of actions to help support older people living in low-income households. These actions include tripling the full insecurity fund, free bus travel for everyone over the age of 60, help with energy efficiency through Warmer Homes Scotland, as well as replacing DWP's cold weather payment with our new winter heating payment. In addition, our £3.2 million Social Isolation and Loneliness Fund is supporting 53 projects across Scotland to help provide warm spaces, hot meals, group activities and fuel payments to people most at risk of isolation, including older people.
Bob Doris.
Cabinet Secretary, the ongoing lack of uptake of pension credit in Scotland means 123,000 of our poorest Scots pensioners are losing out an average of £3,500 a year and will also miss out on this month's £300 cost of living payment. Presiding Officer, the UK Government must do more to encourage uptake, given a recent initiative by them only included one of Scotland's 32 local authorities. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, whilst acknowledging this is a UK Government responsibility, how the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland can encourage uptake to help tackle pensioner poverty, given the poor, poor track record of the UK Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm very happy to work with Mr Doris to see if there's anything else that can be done by Social Security Scotland, who, of course, deliver our devolved benefits. But this is a reserved benefit, as Mr Doris quite rightly points out. Well, the Scottish Government has now on our benefit take-up strategy number two. There is no such approach from the DWP, but that doesn't mean that there is not a need, certainly, for the Scottish Government to ensure that we're doing everything that we can. And that's why we continue to provide funding for income maximisation, welfare and debt advice, and are committed to increasing the availability of advice within services such as health, education and community settings. Mr Doris is quite right to encourage people to take up what they are entitled to, because the Social Security principles that we stand on is that is a person's individual human right, and they should be encouraged to apply for what they are eligible to.
Supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The inequalities of the gender pension gap are well documented, and the 50s women who lost out on state pension in the WASPI campaign is also well documented. When looking to maximise income support to older people living in poverty, what efforts can the Scottish Government take to support WASPI women?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is an issue which, again, is unfortunately reserved to Westminster and the Scottish Government. Scottish Parliament do not have the powers to alleviate the injustice that WASPI women suffer because of the actions that have taken by successive UK governments, which is a deep disappointment to me, to the Government and to many members across this chamber. But I hope some of the actions and schemes, which I provided information for in previous answers, it shows to the member that we are absolutely determined to support older people in general. It is, although a shame, that we cannot do more to help the WASPI women, but it is out with devolved competence.
Question number three, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Social Justice Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding how to improve access to energy-efficient housing in rural communities.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Ministers routinely discuss cross-portfolio matters. The Scottish Government's ambition is for everyone to have access to a warm, safe, affordable and energy-efficient home that meets their needs. That's why we've committed to deliver 110,000 high-quality, energy-efficient, affordable homes by 2032, 10% of which will be in rural and island areas to help retain and attract people to those communities. And that's on addition to the additional funding that we provide in rural areas, both for social landlords and for homeowners, to improve the energy efficiency of existing homes.
Maurice Golden.
Thank the Minister for that answer. The energy efficiency supply chain is critical to supporting the provision of homes and upgrades, but there is currently a bottleneck in small businesses being able to host apprenticeships, which in turn feeds through to the workforce, such as the need for more meter local engineers to work through backlog of repair work. Will the Minister look at how funding and administrative support can be targeted at local businesses, perhaps through Skills Development Scotland, to support capacity for more apprenticeships in the sector?
Minister.
Thank you. We are active in this area, both in terms of the heat and building supply chain delivery plan, which we've worked on in concert with industry voices, and indeed the work that I take forward in joint discussions with Graham Day from the point of view of the skills and education side of things. I think it might be helpful if I gave an update at the time when we launched the heat and buildings consultation as part of my statement to the Chamber.
And supplementary, Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Some of my constituents who live in Rathall, Bonington, Cottages, Hermiston Village or Blinkbonny are in need of support for energy efficiency and decarbonisation improvements. Many will be unaware that Home Energy Scotland's grant and loan scheme offers a rural uplift. What work is the Scottish Government doing to ensure rural households are aware of all of the home energy funding opportunities available to them?
Minister.
Yes, indeed, we do run regular nationwide marketing campaign to promote the support that's available on offer. And I would encourage any household interested in making energy efficiency or heating improvements to their home, whether they're in a rural or an urban area, to contact Home Energy Scotland for advice and support. They, of course, have a website highlighting the support that's on offer, and their network of regional advice centres also allows us to maximise and tap into local promotional opportunities, including outreach and training sessions. We, of course, keep our approach to engagement and awareness raising under review, and we're keen to work with rural stakeholders to continue to increase awareness of the support that's on offer.
Question number four, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it's providing to third sector organisations in Dumfriesshire to tackle inequalities and support disabled people and people with additional support needs, including supporting them into the workplace.
Minister Emma Roddick.
We recognise the third sector plays a vital role in supporting work to tackle inequalities and support disabled people. I recognise the importance of clarity and stability to secure third sector resilience and to grow its capacity. To help support the third sector with fairer funding, we will produce a plan to deliver improvements, including greater clarity and consistency of existing arrangements. We meet regularly with third sector and disabled people's organisations, supporting many in Dumfriesshire and across Scotland with a range of investments, including £5 million from the Equality and Human Rights Fund.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I want to highlight in particular the work of The Usual Place in Dumfries, and I've been working on a cross-party basis with Emma Harper, Colin Smith and Willie Rennie to secure additional Scottish Government support for their vital work. They've hit a roadblock where it seems that they don't fit any of the existing funding options, and I wondered whether the Minister would commit to looking again to ensure the viability of the very important work they do to get young people into long-term employment, successful work work the Scottish Government should support?
Minister.
I thank the member for the question, and I am aware of the work that he and colleagues, including Emma Harper, have been carrying out to draw attention to the situation of the usual place. I know that my colleague Neil Gray, the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work, did provide signposting around where the organisation could go for further support, and that the First Minister confirmed that £50,000 of funding would be made available for 23-24, but that the Scottish Government, much like the usual place, is subject to the same volatile financial situation that has caused these financial difficulties, so there is no more at this time.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Oliver Mundell has mentioned, cross-party colleagues have been working together to support the usual place, and the usual place does provide invaluable support for young people living with additional support needs by helping them to contribute to society through gaining skills, qualifications and experience in the world of work. So I would just like to reiterate Mr Mundell's ask to ask the Minister to commit to doing all she can to provide support for the usual place with advice, guidance and any support that she can offer so that the usual place is here for the future.
Minister.
I'm once again grateful to Emma Harper, both members, for raising the issue. As I said, we have provided signposts and information and asked the organisation to reach out to the local third sector interface. I'm more than happy to provide similar information again and to speak with the members. But as I say, we are all facing the same volatile financial situation thanks to Tory mismanagement down south. So unfortunately, there is not a whole lot of extra money to be working with.
Question number 5, Rosa Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government how it works collaboratively to tackle depopulation in rural areas of the Highlands and Islands region.
Minister Emma Roddick.
Our Building a New Scotland paper on migration in an independent Scotland sets out how migration is vital to rural and island communities' futures. And I heard this firsthand on Monday in Fort Augustus from hospitality and seafood sector representatives, where we discussed the importance of attracting and retaining people to support rural and island areas to thrive. In the meantime, our Addressing Depopulation Action Plan will build on existing collaboration with Highlands and Islands local authorities, both through a population roundtable jointly chaired by the Scottish Government and COSLA, and through our support for the Convention of the Highlands and Islands Population Working Group's oversight of community settlement officers who deliver place-based interventions supporting population attraction and retention.
Rosa Grant.
The Minister will be aware of the BT and their subcontractor Blue Arrow redundancies in Owness. The only option open to BT staff is to relocate to Dundee or Manchester, causing rural depopulation. The BT Group has been the benefactor of hundreds of millions of pounds of government money through their partners Openreach and EE, yet they thumb their noses undermining government policy. Can I ask if the Minister has met with BT on this issue? If so, what response she has had and what interventions have been made by the government and their agencies and what action they are taking to protect BT's loyal workforce in Owness?
Minister.
Certainly, growing up in Owness, I am aware of the issue that the member raises. I'm more than happy to speak with my colleagues in the Fair Work portfolio to provide the member with any further information on conversations that have been happening with BT around the plan closure.
Question number 6, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to tackle the reported record levels of homelessness in Scotland.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Homelessness levels are on the rise in all parts of the UK. I am meeting with housing conveners across the country to discuss the challenges in reducing the number of households in temporary accommodation and supporting councils to develop targeted plans to address local need. The impact on local authorities of increasing homelessness presentations has been compounded by the UK Government's decision to streamline the asylum process, placing increased pressure on housing and homelessness services. The Minister for Equalities, Migration and Refugees recently wrote to the UK Government seeking funding for local authorities to manage the unprecedented pressures created by fast-tracked asylum decisions. I hope this is something that Jackie Bailey and her colleagues can support this ask.
Jackie Bailey.
And I thank the Minister for that response. He will know that in the past year alone, some 39,000 indeed homeless applications have been made, which is the highest number on record. The number of people forced to sleep rough has doubled since last year, and over 6,000 children have been stuck in temporary accommodation for over a year. Shelter Scotland stats show that on average 45 children a day become homeless in Scotland, and I'm sure he would agree that that's shameful. So what action is the Minister taking to urgently deliver support to people who are facing homelessness and at its extreme rough sleeping, and will he join Shelter and local authorities like Hug Island Butte and declare this crisis as a housing emergency?
Minister.
Thank you, Billy, for that question. There's a number of actions that we've undertaken. The First Minister and I visited Fife in July, in August, on the recommendations of the Task and Finish Group on temporary accommodation. Obviously launched £60 million acquisitions fund and also around about allocation. I've been speaking to local authorities about that, how that's implemented in their own local areas. Obviously there's prevention duties which will come forward in the forthcoming housing bill around about that, and I also set up a ministerial oversight group which includes 9 ministers, which looks at that overall issue in terms of solving homelessness, for example around about drugs abuse, looked after children, for a few examples. And I think that's an incredibly important thing. In regards to empty homes, I had a meeting at the Housing Summit in Edinburgh, for example, just on Tuesday, talking about how we bring empty homes back into operation as well. So there's a number of things we're looking at as well. We also spend £85 million a year on discretionary housing payments that we don't need to spend, which we should be able then to spend on homelessness. And again, that's something I would urge Labour Party colleagues to try and support and urge the UK Government to change that. Local housing allowance, again, has been frozen for around about 4
Thank
years.
Thank you, Minister. We need to move to the next MSP and supplementary, Masbury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This time last week, councillors from all 5 political parties on Edinburgh City Council, including the Minister's own party, declared Scotland's capital city is in a housing emergency and needs significant and urgent additional support to meet the needs of the people of Edinburgh. Does the Minister accept that Edinburgh is in the housing emergency, and what emergency response will ministers now give to Edinburgh City Council?
Yeah. Minister.
It's a challenging situation, and Mr Briggs and I were obviously at the Edinburgh Housing Summit on that. I've met Edinburgh now probably at least half a dozen times since being in post. 7 months ago, we are looking at targeted interventions. There are interventions that the council needs to do, such as empty homes that we talked about, such as allocations, which they mentioned and spoke to in our meeting. So we'll work very closely with them in terms of what we need to do to try and support that. But we are working very closely. As I said, I've met with them at least half a dozen times since being in post.
A supplementary, Ivan McKee.
The root cause of Scotland's housing shortage is, of course, a lack of housing supply. Can I ask what the increase in housing supply was across all tenures last year, and what number the Scottish Government plans to increase this to?
Minister.
Yeah, can I thank the member for his question? The number of all sector new builds in Scotland increased by 7% last year, 1,481 homes to 23,346 in the year to end June. That's the highest annual increase, highest annual figure since 2008. We're committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes target by 2032, of which at least 70% will be for social rent. And a recently published Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan supports our commitment to deliver at least 10% of the target in rural and island communities. The 10,757 delivered to the end of June is the highest annual figure since the start of the statistical figures in 2000.
Thank you. Question number 7, Sharon Derry.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what support it offers to local authorities to help reduce the number of people in social housing waiting lists.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Yes, thank you. Probably touch on some of the points that I mentioned to Jackie Bailey. The Scottish Government is supporting local authorities and registered social landlords with a range of approaches to local housing stock management, including large-scale flipping of tenancies, effective void management and greater allocations to homeless households. We will target £2 million at local authorities facing the most significant temporary accommodation pressures. This will support stock management activity and provide the resource needed to deploy capital monies effectively. We're also making £3.5 billion available over this Parliament towards the delivery of 110,000 affordable homes target, with at least 70% of homes to be for social rent. In our own region in South East Scotland, there was an increase from the last Parliament of £107 million, more than 20% increase for the applications.
Sharon Derry.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Official statistics show that there are more than 240,000 people in social housing waiting lists. The number of children waiting for a social housing placement is 100,000. Councils are being overwhelmed with applications from people in need. Yet the Government has presided over a series of cuts to council and housing budgets. Therefore, can the Minister, or will the Scottish Government, increase the funding to councils so that they can help people find the home that they need?
A number of points on terms of that. When I'm going around speaking to local authorities and housing associations, the biggest barrier to more building houses just now is inflation. exactly? Is inflation. Construction inflation was around about 15 to 20%. So if you're talking about our £3.5 billion budget we've set aside, that's effectively been cut in its value by £700 million. So that's the biggest feedback that I get. Go speak to housing associations, speak to local authorities. They will tell you the same thing. And again, one of the key things I'd mentioned to Jackie Bailey was about the local housing allowance. A study by the Institute of Fiscal Studies showed that only 5% of properties were suitable then for people on benefit. The UK government, and this is where Sharon Dowie can be really helpful, I speak to UK government colleagues, unfreeze local housing allowance, and you'll see a massive difference in what we can do with what we have with the powers here.
And thank you. And supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister advise what effect the cut in the UK's capital funding allocation this year is having on the Scottish Government's ability to support local authorities to invest in social housing? And what impact he expects the anticipated 16% real terms UK Government cut over the next 5 years to capital will have on social housing provision?
Minister.
Can I thank the Member for his question? The impact of the UK Government's economic mismanagement is causing soaring inflation, as I touched on in my previous answer. Ongoing austerity and is putting pressure on the Scottish Government's budget. The UK Government did not inflation-proof their capital budget, which has meant a 7% real terms fall in our Barnett capital funding between 23-24 and 27-28, which significantly impacts our ability to deliver our capital infrastructure commitments. Our £752 million budget this year has been supplemented by a £15 million contribution from Heat and Buildings Fund and donations from our charitable one programme that will be able to invest in more social rented homes.
And question number 8, Russell Finlay.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Social Justice Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the impact of crime on poverty.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recognises the strong relationship between deprivation and crime. Both our Vision for Justice in Scotland and Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan recognise the need to work together to mitigate the impact of poverty and reduce the number of people who have contact with the justice system. Tackling poverty is at the heart of what we do as a government and is discussed regularly by ministerial colleagues. We are allocating almost £3 billion in 23-24 to support policies which tackle poverty and to protect people as far as possible during the ongoing cost crisis.
Russell Findlay.
Thank you. The single biggest cause of homelessness for women is domestic abuse, but many are trapped by poverty, with Rape Crisis saying, and I quote, "Safety should not have a price tag, but for too many women, the cost of leaving an abusive relationship is simply unaffordable." A pilot project will financially support those seeking to escape a violent relationship, but it's 3 years late and it's limited to just 5 local authorities. So what are women in the rest of Scotland supposed to do?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Leavers Fund, which the member mentions, is one example of the support which government, the local authorities and third sector can give to women fleeing domestic violence. And it is very important that we do continue to see that in the round, which is why I would point the member to the other policies that are involved and are equally safe to ensure that we are supporting women at their most vulnerable time, and that is what the government intends to do.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position, should they wish. Thank you.